Photosynthesis for plants is a little bit like if, as a human, you could just lay in the sun in a nice afternoon and create directly in your stomach a creamy lentil soup or a sandwich of your choice. Hello, angels, and welcome to the Glucose Goddess Show. I'm Justine Chospé. I'm a biochemist obsessed with helping you understand your body and food. And today, we're going to discuss how these little guys, these little plants, are made, where they come from, and why you should absolutely care, because it has everything to do with carbs. So let's get started. Plants do not get enough credit. If this little tiny cute plant on my desk could talk, it would tell us the story of its ancestors. After all, its ancestors invented the most important biological process on Earth ever. Let me explain. It was once assumed that plants made themselves out of soil, out of the dirt in the ground. Well, in the 1600s, a scientist by the name of Jean-Baptiste van Helmont set out to understand whether that was exactly the case or not. Here's what he did. He performed a 5-year-long test known as the Willow experiment, from which humans learned two things. One, that plants are not made out of soil. And two, that van Helmont was very, very, very patient. So here's how it went down. Van Helmont planted a 5-pound baby willow tree in a massive pot filled with 200 pounds of soil. And for the next 5 years, he just grabbed some popcorn, sat back in his chair, and watched the tree grow. Then, after those 5 years had passed, van Helmont took the tree out of the soil and weighed it. The tree now weighed 169 pounds, 164 more pounds than the baby willow tree that he had planted 5 years ago. But here's where it gets really interesting. The amount of soil in the pot had not changed. There was still 200 pounds of soil in that pot. So with this experiment, he realized that the matter that composed the tree could not have come from the soil, because the soil was still there, and the tree was now 164 pounds heavier than it was. So, how do plants make their plant stuff if it isn't from the soil? Well, plants invented an incredible solution. Here's what they do. Plants invented the ability to transform not the soil, but the air around them into their matter. This plant here, all its matter here, is made out of the air. So plants, they take carbon out of the air and they take water and they combine the two to form a molecule that they then use to create every single part of themselves. To do this, they use the energy from the sun. So they take the carbon from the air, the water, energy from the sun, and they create the molecule that we now call glucose. For hundreds of years after the Willow experiments, scientists across the world tried to figure out this process of photosynthesis. And the three men who finally cracked the code then won the Nobel Prize for their discovery. Their names were Melvin Calvin, Andrew Benson, and James Bassham. The process originally was not called photosynthesis. They named it the Calvin-Benson-Bassham cycle, obviously, but now we call it photosynthesis. Well, thank you so much, guys. And I'm personally quite envious of the way that plants create themselves, because out of this glucose, they not only create their structural matter, they create all their energy, and they don't even have to go to the grocery store. Photosynthesis for plants is a little bit like if, as a human, you could just lay in the sun in a nice afternoon and create directly in your stomach a creamy lentil soup or a sandwich of your choice. Plants do something truly amazing with this process. Once created, plants can either burn glucose for energy or keep it intact and build themselves out of it. And listen, you could not dream of a better brick. Glucose is so tiny and nimble that you could fit 500,000 molecules of it in the period at the end of a sentence. Hey, really quickly, if you can't always do my food hacks and you want to eat the carbs that you love with less impact on your glucose levels, I created a capsule just for that. It's called Anti-Spike Formula. You take two before a meal. It cuts the glucose spike of carbs by up to 40%, 100% made out of plants and tested by over 25 clinical trials. Link is in the description. Okay, back to the episode. So, what do plants transform glucose into? Three main important things. Plants can attach glucose molecules to each other and store them for later use. That's what's called starch. So plants can create starch by assembling glucose molecules together in long chains. And plants store this starch in their roots or in their seeds. For example, any root vegetables like potatoes or carrots are full of starch because the plants have stored lots and lots of it there. The second thing that plants can do with glucose is transform it into fiber. Fiber is a wonderful substance that gives plants their ability to stand up. If this little guy didn't have any fiber in it, he would just collapse into a liquid. And finally, plants can transform glucose into a substance that is very sweet, called fructose. And plants store fructose in their fruit in order, one, to condense energy, and two, to make these fruits irresistible to animals who will eat them and therefore transport the seeds of the plants far and wide. This glucose burning system was invented by plants and then was used by every single living thing. From dinosaurs back in the day, to dolphins, to us, to humans. Yes, we run on glucose. Every cell in our body uses glucose to provide energy to their system. But you might be wondering, how do we get glucose? Because humans don't photosynthesize things out of thin air. Well, the main way that we give glucose to our body is simply by eating plants. And when we eat these plants, we're eating starch, fiber, fructose, and glucose. And these molecules form the family that we now refer to as carbohydrates. We call them carbohydrates because they come from carbon in the air and hydro, water. Carbohydrates are the marriage of carbon and water. So when we eat carbs, they turn back into glucose as we digest them. And that is how we get the glucose that we need. So when we eat a carrot, when we eat a potato, we're eating starch. That starch then breaks down in our body and releases individual glucose molecules that our body can use for energy. Now, the one element that we don't often refer to as a carbohydrate in our current language, in our modern language, is fiber. Even though scientifically fiber is part of the carbohydrate family, because fiber is the only one of them that does not turn back to glucose, we generally don't call fiber a carb. But scientifically, it is a carb. However, going forward, when I talk about carbs, I'm talking about things that contain starch or things that contain sugar like fructose. And even if we don't eat plants, glucose is so important to our body that we make it from within, from other sources like protein. So why am I telling you this long story about the plant and the photosynthesis and the dolphins? Well, because I want you to understand that because our body is wired to seek out glucose for energy, it's no wonder we love eating carbs. There's a deep biological ancestral programming that tells us to seek out foods that are going to give our body glucose. Now, here's the thing. The food environment we live in today does not look anything like the way nature intended us to consume glucose. A candy bar is not the same as an ancestral apple. A candy bar gives way too much glucose way too quickly to our body. And too much of a good thing hurts us. Too much glucose today is the cause of type 2 diabetes, creates cravings, fatigue, inflammation, premature aging, mental health issues. A long, long, long list of symptoms and conditions are linked to the fact that we're now eating way too much glucose. But what I like to say is that it's not our fault. We need to navigate this complex system, this complex food landscape that has created products specifically because they are addictive. Food companies create products that are as addictive and palatable as possible so that we keep coming back for more and buying more and more of their products. So how do we do? Because we cannot fight this evolutionary programming, this love for carbs. What we do is we learn how to eat some of these carbs we love with less impact on our body. And this is where my glucose hacks come in. I've synthesized, from all the latest scientific research, 10 super easy principles that are going to teach you how you can eat the candy bar, how you can eat the pasta, how you can eat the bread and the cookies with less impact on your body. If you use the hacks, you will be able to give your body a steady, healthy amount of glucose that it needs for energy without going overboard and then causing damage. Some of my favorite hacks, I'll tell you, and there's a link in the description of this episode if you want a free one-pager of all the hacks that you can download. Favorite hacks: savory breakfast instead of a sweet one, putting clothing on your carbs. And actually, this one is quite interesting because the concept of clothing your carbs, which means adding some protein, fat, or fiber to carbs that you eat, is actually repackaging carbs into a model that is more natural to us. Because in nature, wherever there were carbs, there was also fiber, as I mentioned. And fiber slows down how quickly we absorb carbs and slows down the glucose spike that they might create. Another really awesome one: move after eating carbs. That way you give your body and your muscles the opportunity to soak up some of the glucose that you just ate instead of it hanging around and creating a big damaging glucose spike. But lots more of where that came from. Click the link in the description to get the one pager with the 10 hacks. And that's all we have time for today. I hope you enjoyed this little biology lesson. Thank you for being here, and I'll see you next time.